Hachette Audio presents The Timewaster Diaries by Robin Cooper. Read by Paul Whitehouse.
January. Saturday, January the 1st. Rita fell down the stairs at 22 minutes past midnight on New Year's Day. I had hoped for a better start to my diary, perhaps a quote from a famous diarist such as Shakespeare, wroteth another play today. But writing a diary is all about recording what actually happens. And sadly, at 12:22, what actually happened was Rita falling down the stairs. I was in the loft at the time, putting the finishing touches to my anti-bird device. Recently, we've been having a lot of problems with pigeons and nesting birds. My bird beddy is designed to lure the winged beasts into a sort of holding pen made from old clothing and cricket stumps. Once inside, the bird triggers a tape recorder, which plays a cassette of my friend Tony Sutton whistling lullabies. The theory is that the bird, subdued by the gentle melodies, falls into a deep sleep, and all I have to do is remove it. In practice, a chubby wood pigeon was using a pair of my underpants as its nest. When I heard the crash from below, I hurried downstairs to find Rita lying on her back, clutching her ankle. "You'd better get the car," she said. "I've done it again." Rita and her ankle have never got on. Last year, we made a succession of ankle-related visits to the hospital. 1. Fell downstairs, times 2. 2. Foot caught in seatbelt when getting out of car, fell out of car. 3. Foot caught in seatbelt when getting into car, fell into car, then out of car. 4. Dropped hammer on ankle, my fault. 5. Trod in bucket of water, Tony's fault. 6. Sprained it whilst asleep, nightmare about the Olympics. After waiting 5 hours in accident and emergency, during which time I saw a man in a neck brace trying to bite a nurse, we returned home. Rita is on crutches again. Poor Rita. Still, at least managed to get through the day without having our discussion. Sunday, January the 2nd. Got up super early today, and after a breakfast of cereal, eggs, some more cereal, and some more eggs, I wrote out my New Year's resolutions. Robin Cooper's official 10 New Year's resolutions. 1. Start writing a diary. Can tick that one off now. 2. Stop writing so many letters. 3. Become a world-renowned, or at least locally renowned, inventor. 4. Learn to whistle. 5. Tidy up shed. 6. Cut down on toffees. 7. Visit Mothermore. 8. Get Tony to stop using my shed as a drinking den. NB, urgent. 9. Rectify employment situation. And 10. Sort out Rita's wretched ankle problem for once and for all. After my resolvements, I helped Rita wash, which was a bit of an ordeal, crutches slipping in shower, and then did crossword. Have no idea what Greek hat face is, but it seemed to fit 5, 3, 4 across. In the afternoon, Tony popped round, without Susan as usual, to wish us a happy new year. He brought flowers for Rita, which looked suspiciously like the ones from Mr. Alfonso's window box next door, and a can of ale for me. Since I do not drink ale, a fact Tony is only too well aware of, he said, "Oh, I never knew that, Robin. Sorry about that, mate," then finished it in one gulp. The cheek! Still haven't heard from Michael. It's been nearly a month now. Was feeling a little melancholy, so went into his bedroom and sat down. Rita joined me. I could see that she was also feeling sad, so I put my arm around her, and together we remained there for about half an hour, looking out into our son's room. It's funny, I'd never realised just how many photographs Michael has of his best friend Simon. I can't imagine myself having a framed photograph of Tony right by my bed, but I guess that's the younger generation for you. In the evening, I popped into the loft to check on the bird beddy situation. Wood Pigeon was now using my dressing gown as a blanket and lying underneath it as if he was actually in bed. Tried to retrieve it, but received a nasty nip. If my invention is to take off, and I'm sure it will, I will have to make a few refinements. Monday, January the 3rd, bank holiday. Wrote a joke today. Was particularly pleased with it because it's a topical joke. Apparently they're the hardest to write because of their topical nature. I say. Do you know why they call it a bank holiday? Yes, because the banks are on holiday. I say. But do you know why the banks are on holiday? Yes, because the bank workers need a rest. I say. But do you know why the bank workers need a rest? No, I don't. I say. Because this joke has worn them out. Read it out to Rita, who seemed to laugh, but she insisted on putting her glasses on first so she could listen better. Afterwards, I called Tony and treated him to a live performance. When I finished, there was silence. And then Tony said, "Could you repeat the joke, please, Robin?" I retold the joke. "Once more?" This I did. After my third performance, there was a very long pause. I waited nervously. Suddenly, Tony exploded in fits of laughter. "That is the funniest joke I've ever heard in my life," he said, coughing and spluttering into the phone. "Tell me it again." I'm going to send it into the local paper. They're running a joke competition at the moment called Local Follies. And this week's prize is a mini snooker table. If Tony's reaction is anything to go by, I shall be mini snookering in no time at all. I wish myself luck. Thursday, January the 6th. Robin, what are you going to do about a job? Our discussion has begun. Rita finally confronted me about my misdemeanour at the end of last year, and now there's a terrible atmosphere in the house. I told her I regretted losing my job, but that working in the customer complaints department for a company that manufactured magnets was never going to propel the Coopers into the Super League. This only seemed to make things worse, though, as Rita replied, "Thanks to your letters, we're now in the bottom division." She's right, I suppose. If I hadn't written all of those letters on company time, or more specifically got caught writing all those letters on company time, then I'd be on the bus to and from work right now. Instead, I find myself neither on the bus nor in work. I try to explain, as I have done so many times, that each letter was a potential gold mine, and that if just one of my ideas had been taken up, just one, we would both be living like Sir and Sir-S Richard Branson. Such is the penalty one must pay as an inventor. "Well, you better hurry up and invent £500, said Rita. "You owe them that for the stamps." And with that, she stormed, well, limped out of the room. Friday, January the 7th. Felt positively negative about everything today. I've really let myself down. Worse still, I've let Rita down. In fact, I'd even go so far as to say I've besmirched the Cooper name itself. I have become a besmircher, and no one likes a besmircher. I've promised Rita that I will redeem myself and find a new job. I told her that I knew it was going to be hard, as I'm not as young as I used to be, although younger than I will be, but that everything was going to be fine, as I still had a lot to offer, even at 52 and a half. With that in mind, I went into the shed and wrote out the following list. What I, Robin Cooper, have to offer at age 52 and a half. 1. Myself. That goes without saying. 2. I am punctual. 3. I am polite. I will always open a door for a lady and close it for a gentleman. 4. Am very good with numbers, i.e. pi, which is roughly 3.2. 5a. I have experience working with others. 5b. But can also work on my own, i.e. in shed. 6. Can operate calculator and telephone and both at same time. After a while, I grew a little tired and so lay down on the floor with my head propped up against a soft bag of manure. Unfortunately, I must have dozed off because when Rita found me, it was already 7 p.m. I'd been asleep for 6 hours. She was not happy and wouldn't even let me have third helpings of potatoes at dinner. Saturday, January the 8th. Wood pigeon in loft, still using dressing gown as bed. Still has a nasty temper and bite. Have named my winged nemesis Smithy after the cartoon character Smithy Woodpecker. Sunday, January the 9th.
Oh, hark! Hurrah! Michael finally phoned today.
Michael's now in Sydney, in Australia, and working part-time for a big company. Since it's a law firm, however, he said he couldn't give us his office number yet for legal reasons, and that his Australian mobile phone didn't connect to British ones because of the distance. But he was well, his friend Simon was well, and he was having a terrific year. I can't tell you, dear diary, just how happy I was to hear my dear son's voice.
Well, I can tell you, because I'm supposed to tell you everything.
Anyway, I was beaming, and so was Rita, despite her hobblements. In the evening, Rita's sister Linda popped round and I opened a bottle of fizzy, i.e. wine with fizzy bubbles in it, and we all toasted Michael's good health. Linda, who had earlier consulted an astrological book free with a ladies' magazine, said that she was sure this was going to be a terrific year for the Coopers. And why not?
Monday, January the 10th. Rita was back at work today, but as her ankle is still rather delicate, I gave her a lift in. As usual, Rita accused me of going too slowly. You're not a driving instructor anymore, etc. And this soon escalated into an even bigger argument about my work situation, i.e. my non-work situation. Oh, alas. After lunch, butter sandwiches, my favourite, I put on my jacket, wrapped my scarf around me and with a pocket full of trusty toffees walked round to the job centre. I haven't been into a job centre for over 20 years, but apart from a few more computers, it was pretty much the same, i.e. lots of men coughing. Took a couple of pamphlets, had a bit of a cough, came home and sat in shed. Tuesday, January the 11th. Went to Mother's this evening, brought her some grapes and her beloved Reader's Digest magazine. This month's issue had an article all about ghost barges. Apparently sightings are quite common, although I've certainly never seen one. Your hair looks nice, said Rita as soon as we walked in, more out of shock than politeness, I think. Mother's hair was completely blonde. Thank you, dear, said Mother. Mr. Lawrence has given me a more natural look this week. Rita and I exchanged glances. As ever, Mother's television set was on at full blast in the living room. In fact, it was so loud that it caused her collection of mini glass bells, 86, and mini china bells, 64, to tinkle all around the room. Today she was watching a programme all about DIY. Robin, dear, she said, doesn't that handsome man with the hammer remind you of your father? I think Mother's eyesight must be going the same way as her hearing. I don't remember Father being Chinese.
Wednesday, January the 12th. Have just realised that there's no such thing as Smithy Woodpecker. It's Woodsy Woodpecker. Silly me. But I'm sort of used to the name Smithy now, so Smithy it is. Have to admit, I've also grown rather fond of the bird, so I've decided to let him carry on snoozing in peace. Haven't dared tell Rita what's going on, though. She's never really liked birds since she was attacked by that jay.
Thursday, January the 13th. Alas, I won't be playing mini snooker. My joke didn't win the local follies competition. I was so disappointed I couldn't eat a thing for breakfast. Although in the end I did manage to get down a couple of boiled eggs, a few pieces of toast, and some cereal. As an unbiased onlooker, I can safely say that my joke was far superior to that of the victors. Here, and it pains me to write this, is the winning joke by a Miss Lisa Bradley. What time is it when an elephant steps on your car? Time to buy a new car. Now what's so funny about that, Miss Bradley? I am going to send a letter to the judges. I shall get to the bottom of this.
Saturday, January the 15th. 2. The judges of the Local Follies Joke Competition, the Brent Herald local newspaper. Dear judges, what is going on? Last week I formally and officially entered my joke into your Local Follies Joke Competition, fully expecting to win. It was very good. And yet it was not deemed fit for victory. How on earth a riddle about a clumsy elephant could beat one about a national and royally appointed British holiday is a mystery to me. I beg you to reconsider. Best wishes, Robin Cooper.
Monday, January the 17th. Started using a new toothpaste today called Mentathon 3000. It's particularly minty.
In fact, no sooner had my toothbrush entered my mouth than I was overcome with a feeling of sheer invincibility. Such is the power of mint.
Wednesday, January the 19th. After breakfast, I went to make some copies of my CV in Mr. Singh's shop. Mr. Singh has recently purchased a photocopying machine, which he claimed was the future of news agency, as well as a laminating device. Lamination is also part of the future, Robin. 1 hour and 5 minutes later, I was walking out with 50 glorious copies of my curriculum vitatis, each one encased in bright green plastic sheeting. They look fantastic, and I'm sure everyone will want to meet me now. I know I would. Sadly, Rita wasn't so keen. She said they looked more like menus, and that if I had any spare ones, she could use them as placemats. The cheek! Thursday, January the 20th. Was severely excited to receive my first letter of the year from my Swiss-German pen friend, Gunter Schwarz, today. What exciting times! I have been corresponding with Gunter for nearly 40 years now, and I can safely say that his English gets worse with each letter. My dear friendly Robin, herald the new year. How have you been going? I do hope the festivities have not left you bereft of feeling. We are all saying so, but who will it be? We do hope so. I am now finding myself in a particular situation because of the problems with the house handles. I have since attempted a reprimand, but to no effects. You would not believe it, but I tell them otherwise. What are we to be doing, Robin? The house handles cannot be lifted or even pulled along. When my father is trying to bind them with kindlung, this caused so much slippage that it is making him a pain of the face. How is Rita's ankle bonies? Did they decide what is best to her? Or did they say otherwise? Please let me in the know. I am awaiting with impatience. Zurich is full up with the snow. Hurry up, son, and make water fast. Heidi is also sending her regardments. Your ever friendly, Gunter Schwarz. The house handles saga has been going on for months now. Every letter seems to have some mysterious reference to house handles, but we have absolutely no idea what house handles are. Unfortunately, it's too late to ask now. Instead, Rita and I wrote out the following list on the easy white message board on the fridge. House handles might be 1. A type of door handle, but much heavier. 2. Straps of some sort, probably unlikely. 3. Banisters that keep snapping. 4. An anvil, but I don't recall Gunter ever showing any interest in metalwork stroke blacksmithery or anvils. 5. Something that is only ever used by Swiss Germans and no one else in the world. We think it's probably number 5. Friday, January the 21st. Sat in shed and scoured paper for jobs. No opportunities for budding inventors, but I did find the following. 1. Clerk in insurance office. 2. Clerk in other insurance office. 3. Self-starting above-the-line resolutions officer in exciting forward-thinking company. Not quite sure what this meant, but I'm certainly a self-starter and definitely an exciting forward thinker. Wrote off to all the above and enclosed a copy of my shiny new CV. Then cleaned my teeth again for 10 minty minutes and popped out to the postbox. Stopped to have a look at the jobs advertised in Mr. Singh's shop window. Was amazed at just what people advertise these days. Amongst the electricians, Spanish language teachers and gardeners was an advert for 40 prams for hire and another from an Italian lady, 36, 28, 32, offering professional bubble bath, whatever that means. 5 minutes later, and £2.25 new pence poorer, I too had joined their hallowed ranks and become an advertiser. My advert. Do you want to drive? Do you? Do you? Well, now you can, for I am Robin Cooper, professional, driving instructor. Don't hesitate. Learn to drive before it's too late. Call now. I wish myself luck. Monday, January the 24th. How dare they? How dare they? From Local Follies Department, The Brent Herald. To Robin Cooper, Bronsbury Villas, London. Dear Mr. Cooper, I say, thank you for your letter.
I say. I hope you're feeling better. I say. Sorry you didn't win. I say, but your joke went in the bin. Yours sincerely, Ted G. Fetfus. Tuesday, January the 25th. Opened the shed door this morning to find Tony sprawled across the floor, clutching a can of Pennyfeather's ale and sporting three nasty bumps on his head. When I asked him what had happened, he replied, "Shoe, ashtray, clock." This could only mean one thing. Susan. Tony and Susan have been married now for 16 years, but I don't think they've been truly happy for 16 years, excluding the wedding day, which Tony was too drunk to remember. To be fair, Tony probably isn't the easiest person to live with, although it must be hard being married to a woman who never goes out and only ever wears pink. I made Tony a cup of tea and a cup of coffee, his patented hangover cure, brought him some toast, he got butter all over his moustache as usual, and lent him one of my shirts, which I'm sure I will never see again. Then, as it was late, I gave him a lift into work. We didn't say much on the way, although Tony did mention that he thought I was a very slow driver. The cheek! Wednesday, January the 26th. Saw a sad sight this afternoon. There was a lady tramp. Are they called trampettes? Sprawled right across the bench on the high street. She must have been in her 60s and was ever so grubby, the poor wretch. I took pity on her and gave her 50p. And when I looked at her closely, I noticed she had the kindest eyes I think I'd ever seen in my life. So I gave her another 50p. She thanked me and then took a big bite out of an onion. By the way, no one at the local paper goes by the name of Ted G. Fetfus, and nobody has ever heard of him. I was incensed. That mini snooker table should...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.